Fujifilm is a pioneer in diagnostic imaging. With over 70 years of expertise, we put cutting-edge tools in our customers' hands so patients get excellent results. Now we introduce Eluxio Ultra. Eluxio Ultra enhances your existing Eluxio platform by incorporating CAD-i, our powerful AI technology. With CAD-i, Eluxio Ultra is one of the first endoscopy solutions to detect and characterize lesions in real time, delivering our most powerful, complete, and comprehensive package for endoscopists. Eluxio Ultra will accommodate a range of future tools and technologies as they evolve, so our best endoscopy system for your patients today will remain so tomorrow. Human instinct plus artificial intelligence equals Eluxio Ultra, now available for your practice.
Hi everybody, and welcome also on behalf of Professor Thomas Roche, who is co-chairman of Endoscopy on Air, to this Endoscopy on Air sponsored by Fujifilm. So my name is Alessandro Rebici, I'm a gastroenterologist based in Milano, and so glad that we have an outstanding team of QLs, of experts, world-known experts that will be part of this Endoscopy on Air today. And welcome everybody from all over the world. We have so many people registered for the event. We are very grateful to all of you for taking your time and following this event. We have people mostly from Europe and Middle East, but we have also people from other countries. So we're so glad to welcome all of you. And just let me introduce the faculty. We have already on the screen a couple of them. I have just a remark, Helmut and Emmanuel, where is your tie? You see Professor Bandari and Professor Kislich, they are in the perfect Italian style. So Emmanuel and Helmut, please show your tie next time for Fujifilm event. There is a dressing code, you see the guys, how beautiful they are. And Helmut, I could expect this from a man much younger than us, but from you, you are always perfect. So next time, or if you have time, get your tie for the time you have your talk, please. So we have a video message now from the president of Fujifilm Medical. Before going to that video message, Thomas will jump live after the video message. So the people that are being involved in this meeting, they do not need any kind of introduction. Raf Kislich, Emmanuel Coron, Helmut Neumann, Pradeep Bandari. They are super friends, and afterwards they are super experts. They will debate with us, they will present, they will show videos. Pradeep also will show live cases from Portsmouth. So thanks guys for being part of this event. Hopefully everything will go nicely, and if we can run the video now from the president of Fujifilm Medical. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon. I'm very excited to virtually meet you. I'm Toshinabeta, General Manager of Medical System R&D Center of Fujifilm Corporation. First of all, on behalf of Fujifilm, I would like to thank the organizer, especially Professor Rebic and Professor Roche, for giving the opportunity for us to contribute to the event. I'm very pleased to have such a wonderful opportunity to introduce our future technology to everyone. This is our product map of Fujifilm in medical. As you can see, we have a wide range of products that address majority of imaging needs in hospital. We recently added one more thing to this map. Right, in 2018, we announced our launch of medical AI. It can do so many things. I share with you some pieces from it. Writing is outcome of two core technology that we have. One is advanced imaging technology that Fuji has vast amount of assets. The other one is AI technology that we newly developed in three segments: diagnostic, workflow, and reporting. Technology behind RIDE didn't happen overnight. We receive our companies past 40 years of technology. Then we select the best ones. Then we put them in one bag. That's it. It's not so simple, but that's how we did it. We don't stop. We never stop. We continue to invest setting up AI Creation Center in Tokyo. Applying RIDE in medical is actually quite simple. It's automation and efficiency by using AI. We want to reduce the overall process, but we want to increase physicians' time to see more patients. In the last 2 years, we introduced RIDE all over the world. We got so many great comments. We haven't covered all, so we continue this road. Now, let's apply RIDE to endoscopy. CAD I is our new brand in endoscopy CAD. There are two main functions: real-time detection with LCI, and the other is real-time characterization with PLI. LCI is our unique IEE technology, enhancing mucosal visualization for more accurate detection of lesions and inflammation, very effective for real-time polyp detection. PLI enhances mucosal structures and characterizes lesions. With CAD-I, we aim to support analyze if polyp is hyperplastic or neoplastic. My last slide is our corporate message, Never Stop. It's about our endless effort to create value through innovation and contribute to solving social challenges. We have done so and will never stop building on our experience and expertise to help transform the world. With our advanced and unique technologies, I am certain to realize the future world in which everyone can receive more advanced medical care. I wish much success to all experts and participants of Endoscopy on Air. Thank you for your attention.
Well, never stop. That's a good motto also for my very good friend and partner, Ale Repici. So on behalf of him, I welcome you here for Endoscopy on Air event in our little EOA Hamburg studio. And Ale, you might be reassured, I'm wearing a Ferragamo tie. So without further ado, I think we switch to the live demonstration, because that's the special feature of today's meeting, not only lectures and debates, but also live demonstration. And Ale, what are you going to show us?
Can you hear me? Can you see me?
Yes, both.
Yes. So Thomas, first, congratulate for your beautiful tie. I cannot see that, but I'm sure it's beautiful. So let me introduce my team. Always there is Roberta. Where is Roberta? Roberta Maselli. She is the director of endoscopic surgery program here. She does all ESD, POEM, and EMR. So she allowed me to work today. Thanks for giving me this privilege, Roberta. And also we have Elisabetta, Antonio, our fellow, and Alessandra, which is in the back, the anesthesiologist. Alessandra, please come in. We cannot proceed if Thomas doesn't see you. He's our anesthesiologist. So it's a patient that's been referred to us for a skin colonoscopy. So let me introduce also a technology that we're going to use. So as you can see, we latest generation series scope, and this is scope that we use on a routine basis. This is our option. We were the first in Italy, probably the first in Europe, to adopt this technology. All the time we were bottoms, we, especially during COVID time, tried to kind of risk for the patients or for the operators. So we try to use as much as possible disposable devices. And also, please let me, very glad to introduce also the Fujifilm artificial intelligence device. So the Fujifilm is the only company to have on the market with the CE mark already taken of artificial intelligence system that can allow you detection and characterization. Of course, I did not select these patients. The purpose of this colonoscopy was just doing a screening colonoscopy. And as you can see here, what I got is this. So AI is signaling me, is alerting there is something here. So what is the message from this short video? AI is a nice support. So whatever I'm going to see is alarming. There is a superposed blue box bringing my attention where I can miss more polyp. Of course, this may be not relevant. Ladies, 55-year female, screening colonoscopy. I want to get all the polyps possible. I want to reassure patients that the screening colonoscopy has all polyps in the colon. So you see how that works when you switch to BLI, is immediately giving you characterization. It's saying this is an adenoma. So it's important. Yellow sign telling us that it is a tiny adenoma, probably 3 to 5 millimeters. So how to resect this? There are different options. Normally we do cold. We can do cold forceps, or we can do cold polypectomy. So we normally use this kind of snare. So this is MedWork film snare. Name of this snare is cross snare. It's a cross zero. We have two options with snares. There is the cross zero, which is only for cold, and there is in size, can you hold it, please? In the size of 7 and 12 millimeter. We also have another option, which is a hybrid, another that allows you to hold or hold as much as you want. So you can decide according to the polyp size, polyp morphology. So let me remove quickly this polyp. So you see, even though I'm missing the polyp, or I cannot find any longer, still the AI is addressing my attention to the place where the polyp is located. And I will show you now very quickly the of the cold snare. So the other important thing of this cold snare is the metallic tip. I will show you immediately in a few seconds. Okay, you see the metallic when you are acting. So you know cold is mechanical, and when you use this snare, open. Mechanical force. I'm trying right position. So I'm of the okay. The area of the valve. So to me in a little bit more. Okay. Probably I have to change the position. Become. See, contraction is to see the polyp, which will be right here. So, of course, in this situation, you need to be patient. So, it's here. I have a little problem fixing
Ale.
Yeah.
Sometimes the small polyps.
Hope you have a suggestion for me.
Polyps are more, the small ones are more difficult to catch. I prefer to do larger ones sometimes.
Right. But they didn't select for the live procedure, and now I have to get out of this situation. So it's very manual. When advance, you see.
Yeah, and then you are. But that's a good teaching experience, because that's how it is.
Yeah. Let me do again. I know you require to be very fast.
Well, maybe I don't know. I mean, it's would it does it help if you rotate the endoscope?
Okay,
now
I got it. Cut. Oh, you see, thanks to this mechanical, this metallic part, you have a lot of force on the tip, and you can easily resect it. Hopefully, next polyp will be easier. Okay.
Ale, what was very interesting.
So this is a nice example.
It was very interesting because it was kind of semi-blind catching, huh? So if you have so much experience like Ale had, you can put the snare, and then you trust that the snare will do its job even if you don't perfectly see it. Very nice.
Okay, so now, so okay, double check. Okay. Oops. Now. Let me check if I see anything else. So in general, my comment is that for any kind of small clips into the left colon, we are going to use cold resection now all the time, especially if polyps do have pathology. More and more, we are this near all the same. Also, for patients with a serrated style, typically very flat and located by colon. I think the experience that we got is that when you use cold, the rate of is very minimal. So, it is now our first approach when we deal with this small issue. So, you see, I'm looking altogether with artificial intelligence. Sometimes there is the blue box telling me there is something wrong, but duty to double check what I see. Okay, here is normal. Here is normal.
Ale? Do you think these are false positives, or is it, on the contrary, is it necessary that the instrument shows you something you have to check?
I think some false positives, but it's important that you look what the eye is telling you. Among false positives, you find also abnormalities that may be relevant. Okay, so always with that, we use LCI. This is a tiny, very tiny plastic lesion, very innocent. So we'll try to resect it. So it looks like that, of course, highlighting all abnormalities, understand how does it work of the lesions. So you will suggest to remove this or not?
Well,
Thomas,
up to now, it's probably not yet approved to trust the differential diagnosis. So to be on the safe side, you do a quick removal.
Okay. Next, please. To see how it's quickly giving you what we need some more data to make sure the prediction is really valuable. But my feeling is that in the future, histology, probably this is going to be the practice. If it's telling you that it's for plastic, we can skip the removal. So now let me remove the tiny polyp again with the cross, zero, snare open.
Honestly.
So I hope that you were telling me do not remove that to avoid me another difficult situation, but now I'm advancing the scope, sucking a little. Okay. Close, close. Okay. So we have taken the, grasped the polyp. Okay. Remove it. Okay. You see? Quick cut and it's.
Well, honestly, with two generations back, we haven't seen those lesions at all.
Hmm. That's a good point. So, of course, I think we are not going to miss any kind of. And this is also the drop, probably remove a bit more hyperplastic polyp. Advantage, advantage, see, we are not missing polyp, so we are reducing interval. We are increasing the efficiency of our follow-up for our patients. We say 5 years, they are in a safe side. When we say 10 years, they are super safe side because we have screened them using so this technology. Okay. I'm pulling back gently. So the issue of artificial intelligence is that can I see exactly what I can expose? So it's very important. It's a technique of the colonoscopy that you properly expose all the mucosa. So you go up, down, left, right. You try to get all the mucosa exposed like this. Okay. So this is very nice bowel prep. We use now root the 1 liter the volume bowel. And of course, we use a speed modality all the time. So some bubbles. To tell you that also they do not interface too much with our AI system, you see, KDI is being. That much by the bubble, trying to in.
Ale?
Yeah.
Do you think at the end AI will help us to speed up withdrawal, or is that too dangerous?
No. I don't think it's going to speed because still need to expose the mucosa concept. It's not seeing polyps are not exposing to the. So it's still important to take your time, you put the folds, beyond the folds, well distended the mucosal phase because extremely relevant for the efficiency. In general, I would say it's not speeding up, but it's not also delaying or taking much time. We've done this study, is going to be published, this impressive endoscopy together with Cesare Assanz, super expert of AI. So we estimated false positive, we estimated impact on the withdrawal. And we were able to show in this paper that the time when you use AI is increased by 0.7%. So very minimal in terms of time to the withdrawal time. But of course, I will not suggest to fasten the withdrawal time because of AI. Absolutely. I don't know what you think about. We can ask our colleagues, our experts. See, there is another hyperplastic polyp here, you see? So when I Okay, let me focus on polyp here. So it's a matter of being well distended. I start in saying, you see the green box? Okay, so it's hyperplastic. So it takes a very little time. It's almost immediate reaction. So I will not remove this one because clearly hyperplastic. We removed already one. Okay. So we are at the end. Wow. Okay, there is another big polyp here. So I was going to miss that.
Oh.
Wow. Okay. So we have a quite large polyp here. Okay, let me focus on polyp. So like this polyp with different components. So I have here a adenomatous component, and on the left side I have some, it looks like serrated component. Let me look. Let me see how it's classifying. So it's immediately classifying as a neoplastic. But it's a very strange polyp.
Ale?
Let me do like this.
Ale?
Yeah.
But honestly, I don't think that anybody would classify this as hyperplastic, right? It's just too big and in the rectum and...
Yeah.
So what is the... I mean, that's always the crucial question. What's the resection technique you're going to choose? Yeah.
We are very close to the... I'm to hear your suggestion. Also, the expert, what Pradeep, Helmut, Raf, or Emmanuel can suggest to us.
Okay, we will discuss
so
that.
So the problem is, yeah, there is a component that looks like serrated. So my suggestion is that we can prepare to make on this. I will. I do prefer to switch to a gastroscope. And the time we can proceed with the lecture, and afterwards
okay. We
can move back here. Okay. What do you think about this?
Yes. So the you will tell us the decision which resection technique you use when we come back.
Yeah. Before we move to the lecture, can you please ask the expert what they do believe about this, what we should do?
Okay. Let's.
He's starting here.
Start with Pradeep. Is it ESD all the time, this little one?
Yeah. Well, it is on the dentate line. It is on the dentate line. So without a knife, achieving clearance on dentate line will be very difficult. So I think even if you don't do full ESD, at least at the dentate line, you need to cut and release it from there. And then if you do that, might as well do full ESD.
Okay, there was a recent paper in Gut saying by Michael Berg saying that EMR is fine. Maybe any opponent, anybody still sticking to EMR? Emmanuel, for example?
I agree with Pradeep. I think it's very difficult without at least half a circumference on the dentate line. Even if you retroflex, even if you change endoscope, etc., you need to grab the distal part of the lesion, and putting a knife there is very helpful. Probably, I don't know, Pradeep, would you also coagulate the margins preventively, prophylactically with a hot biopsy forceps or a coagrasper, or is that only ESD?
I think, Thomas, the important point here is we all know that rectal polyps have very high risk of cancer. Mm-hmm. We all know that polyps more than 20 millimeter have high risk of cancer. And then also technical challenge of this being on the dentate line. If you put all these three things together, the best treatment will be ESD. I think EMR potentially could be done, but is will be suboptimal because risk of cancer remains high.
Okay, so that's, I think, unfortunately, we have to stop this discussion here, but I realize that ESD is very sticky. I tend to disagree, but we will have a discussion on the resection later on. So going one step back to the artificial intelligence, I think Emmanuel Coron will teach us how to use AI in practical terms. Emmanuel, your lecture, please.
So thank you very much for the invitation and congratulations for the very good demo. I think there are still some questions that are left, and this is very practical guide because like we know, artificial intelligence is very, very rapidly emerging. It's a fantastic field of new technology brought to endoscopy, but there are so far few systems that are commercially available. Of course, CADI system from Fujifilm is presented here and is the only one that allows to perform not only detection, but also characterization. There are two other systems, GI Genius by Medtronic and Pentax Discovery, who perform detection for the moment. And there are large discussions about the indications for AI during colonoscopy procedures. I think everybody will agree it will help detect diminutive colorectal lesions and characterize these lesions to save costs, time, and be more efficient in the future for our patients. But there are lots of questions. Who does benefit the most from AI? Is that junior endoscopist? Is that expert endoscopist? Which of the top lesions for AI? Is that very small lesions, less than 5 millimeter, or very flat lesions like SSLs who are at risk for interval cancers? Or is that bigger lesions like real cancers? And also, when should we use CADI? Is that from the start of colonoscopy, when we go up, or only during withdrawal? Is that using white light or using LCI for detection? And can we use it to ensure the quality of resection? And finally, should we use it all the time? So I would like to share with you our experience here in Nantes. There are two phases. Phase one was this spring. It was the first CADI system with detection, but no characterization. And I found it from the start very attractive. You see here, this is, I think it was my first patient. And while I was cleaning the right colon, my eye got caught on the right inside. You see a very small lesion. Then, of course, we need to center it, but the blue box is stable and showed that it's a very small lesion. When we use LCI, it's also confirmed. And finally, of course, we need to use BLI at this time without characterization. It's only the human eye that is doing the expertise job. And I don't know if you, we don't have time to discuss too much the criteria, but you have seen dark spots and indistinctive borders, clouded surface. And I think everybody agrees that it's a sessile serrated lesion. This is, in the same patient, another lesion in the left colon, which is very translucent. It's seen in white light, also in LCI. When we switch to BLI, again, some dark spots, but this is much more distinct. We see very small white round glands, and it's according to basic classification, an hyperplastic, small hyperplastic polyp. And finally, same patient, so the whole spectrum, third lesion, again in the left colon, and this one is more difficult to see. You see that we need to really get a good exposition of the mucosa. This lesion is confirmed also by LCI. And finally, according to BLI, and with a little bit of zoom here, we see elongated structures, elongated glands with irregular vessels. It's still very well organized. There is no ulceration, depression, etc. It's not suspect of carcinoma. It's only an adenoma, finally, high-grade dysplasia adenoma, according to BASIC. So finally, when we go to the recommendations of the ESG and when we look at the position statement papers, we have this very nice paper released 2 months ago with two important sentences. I won't go into the whole paper, of course, but the first one says that endoscopists performing optical diagnosis should attend validated training courses using externally validated classifications such as NICE, WASP, or BASIC. And secondly, in order to achieve competence, especially for optical diagnosis of diminutive colorectal lesions, then self-learning by assessing at least 120 diminutive lesions prospectively with histological feedback is mandatory. The problem of this is it's very interesting, and of course it's very nice to progress and to get better and better, but the problem is to learn all these classifications, the NICE, the WASP, BASIC, Paris, lateral spreading tumor, CUDO, of course, CONNECT is a new French one. So finally, when we see how systems evolve and what AI can bring to us, the question is, do we still need to learn all of this, and or should we rely only on the computer and on the algorithms? So second phase of our test here in Nantes, it's a small video seeing here and a small polyp that was detected. You see, it was very difficult to see by human eye, but immediately within a second cataract caught it. It was confirmed by LCI, and like Professor Repici shown, when you go to PLI, you have immediately the prediction of cataract. Here it's an adenoma, so it's classified neoplastic, and there are some trips to maximize the usefulness of cataract. There are very simple things to be done, but first it's to remove the mucus from the polyp and clean the lens. Second, to remove the water about the around the polyp, then stabilize the scope and focus on the polyp and avoid elation, and make sure that the target lesion is characterized by checking the position map. So this is another example, very small again lesion, but again well detected, white light, LCI, characterized as neoplastic, and it's a small tubular adenoma by BASIC classification. So well characterized by CADI. And if you switch to a little zoom, then it increases again the confidence in the prediction of the histology. There are a few simple questions. Does it work when you are not very good stabilizing or cleaning, etc., or after injecting the submucosa? Well, surprisingly, it keeps very good, very stable. This is, you will agree, it's not perfect images of a small lesion. It's injected. There is some blood, etc. But again, it's well characterized. It's for sure an adenoma and well characterized by CADI, although the image is not perfect. Another case, very difficult lesion to see. And the question is, does it work with a cap? Yes, it works. And you see this very small, maybe 1-2 millimeter 2A polyp, well detected, characterized as a CADI, as a small neoplastic adenoma. And the nice thing with a cap is that you keep very stable. You can flush a little water, so you get even better images. And then you, of course, are sure of it, but CADI was right, and it's, of course, an indication for resection. And one last example to show that you should not rely all the time or at least there are some situations when we need to keep in mind what we are looking at. This is in the same patient. You see that these two lesions for sure are small polyps that you will characterize with KDI, but there's no need going on that spot, which is only some deposit, some mucus, and that is false positive. So we know what we are looking at. And in the same gentleman, it was in the sigmoid colon. It's to show, to provocate everybody to do the reverse thing, not to start from the macroscopic view, but start from zoom and chromo. And if you rely only on zoom and chromo, you could be tempted to see that, to say that this is neoplastic area with some elongated microvessels, maybe around some glands. But if you step back, do less zoom, you see the whole area is more colored. And then finally, there are diverticula around all this. And this is just a patient when we asked him that had a diverticulitis a couple of days ago. So it's probably only inflammation. And this neoplastic prediction was, of course, something that was not accurate for this situation because there was no real lesion to target. So be sure what you are looking at. And of course, there are some questions to answer. I think it's only personal experience. There are almost no data for the moment. Is that for juniors? Of course. Is that for experts? I think yes. It's impressive the number of situations where it takes, it challenges you and it shows you very small things that I would have overlooked. Which lesions? Of course, the smaller ones are the best ones, but even bigger lesions, especially when they are flat, they are good candidates, I think, for KDI. Larger lesions, for instance, cancers, for the moment are not a good indication in my view. And should we use it from the start of colonoscopy? It's very controversial. I think we need some studies there. Personally, I do not use it when I go up or when I do resection of polyps because it beeps quite often. So I prefer to keep it only during withdrawal, but I need to get it during withdrawal every time I have the system. Is that good for white light or LCI? It's complementary, but it's very effective in both. And can it be used for telling if there is some adenomatous tissue residual after resection? For the moment, I don't think that it's accurate at this stage, but it will probably come back. So in conclusion, AI and especially CADI is very easy and friendly to use. It has excellent ergonomy. It has a minimal but real, I think, 5 to 10 examinations to master the system and would be called the learning curve. Studies are ongoing. There's a multi-center trial in France about characterization. And should we use it all the time? Maybe not at this for the moment, but it will take for sure an enormous importance in our daily practice. Thank you very much for your attention.
Very much, Emmanuel. That was a very, very good teaching course, also skeptical at times, so I like this very much. I think we start discussing this in the round later on. And for the time being, I think we go back to Ale Repici to see what he has done or is doing with the rectal polyp. Ale, injection for ESD or EMR? So we need the sound. Ale, we are back. Okay, the sound is being sent, I'm informed. Well, it's a cap. And it's... So I try to comment. Injection is of paramount importance, and there are actually new solutions which promise to lead to a longer lasting elevation, which also makes resection, especially ESD. So it's ESD again. But this seems to make ESD much easier. Ale, you're coming back with sound. Just in time.
Hey, Thomas, we started already. Okay, so can you hear me?
Yes.
And can you also see me? So I injected the solution with some LVU and some normal saline. I normally mix the LVU to avoid too much bubbles. And I'm using the distal cap from Fujifilm and also the flash knife. So we are using a new flash knife. I understand this prototype not yet available into the market that allows you also to inject. I'm quickly exposing the submucosa. Normally into the rectum, you have to pay attention. There are a lot of vessels. So you need to be very careful.
So the What's the size of the knife, Ale?
So 1.5. Trying to go this direction first and try to see all the tiny vessels. You see, because what I want to avoid right now,
Ale,
is mess with a lot of bleeding, yeah?
Which current do you use?
Okay, can we ask Andrea to focus on our herb generator, super intelligent, much more intelligent than me, so we are using the section Swift, but if Andrea comes, I will show immediately. Okay.
We try to see it. It's a little bit too bright. Okay.
So, Ale, are you planning a full ESD or only a circumferential incision and afterwards placing a snare?
So, this is a good point. I'm not sure I can place the snare because just of the position. As Pradeep mentioned it before, is it just on the anal verge? So, trying to be careful with the borders to avoid recurrence, but I do suspect that I cannot do this with the snare, so let me clean a lot of vessels here.
You know, I love the case very much because it was initially intended only to show the advantage of the cat eye detection mode, but finally we have seen that directly at the end of the procedure, there was a tubular villus adenoma infiltrating the anal verge, and this is a fantastic example even from your expert center that you immediately switch now to ESD. I guess this is really a fantastic demonstration because it was an unintended polyp, because again, the procedure seems to be only intended to
show exactly.
The advantage of cat eye.
Hi, guys, Pradeep
has a question before we go on to the next lecture.
It was just a very quick comment for the audience if they were watching to see that what you're seeing here on the screen is Professor Apici is not moving his knife at all, it's steady. And a minute ago we had a room view showing how his hand was just twisting and torquing the endoscope. So I was just going to illustrate the technique for ESD. It's a beautiful illustration where knife doesn't move at all, only all he's doing is torquing the endoscope with his right hand.
Okay.
This is a very important comment. Thomas, I think we need to move.
Yes, right. I realized that I got into a group of ESD aficionados, but we'll discuss this later with Evelyn in the second session.
Which you are not?
About not always.
So okay, let me show just one point. I think we can use also this as with a flash knife. You see, I am injecting, so there is also injection capability, and this will help me in proceeding with the submucosal dissection. So when you come back, I will go on the anal verge. I will show you the anal side, okay?
Good. So I think we have the next lecture and then give you 2-3 minutes at the end that we see where you are at this stage, Ale. Thanks very much for the beautiful demonstration. Very elegant EST.
So 2-3 minutes will be enough. Okay.
Good. Okay. So the next topic is again with the detection of lesions, and Ralf Kieslich will tell us about the two most important competitors or collaborators, which is mechanical devices and imaging / artificial intelligence, right?
Yes, Thomas, hello. I think it's a perfect match. And first of all, welcome everybody. And can you hear me well?
Yes, absolutely.
So I'd like to show you what is the perfect match, which might be the combination of GI colonoscopy and cat eye colonoscopy. And here you see the video. This video is from the morning, and you see how the balloon is insufflated, which is a permanently balloon at the distal tip of an otherwise normal endoscope. However, it's not a normal endoscope because it's the endoscope from Fujifilm, which has the possibility to do the cat eye imaging. I show you some details of the endoscope. Here you see again the balloon. It's not single use. It becomes part of your regular endoscope. You do the disinfection regularly, and this balloon can really last very long, about the lifetime of your endoscope. You need an insufflator, which is the spark insufflator here. And you see here a foot pedal or a hand pedal where you can insufflate the balloon. What is the idea behind? You go in the cecum, and then during withdrawal, you insufflate the balloon. You can straighten the folds. You can capture the air in front of the balloon. You center your optics, and then you can identify much better polyps behind folds. We made a study of about 1,000 patients, and we compared high-definition colonoscopy compared to GI-aided colonoscopy. And you see here that the adenoma detection rate increased from 37.5% up to 48%. But what we found was more important, that we even could identify more advanced adenomas by using the GI colonoscope. And just to compare what you just have seen with Ale, and he is really an expert, but we have seen a lot of, in my guess, false positive results. Here I switched on the cat eye and I used the GI balloon. You cannot see the GI balloon because it's behind the optic. And here I make the passage over the sigmoid colon, and you see that you have a very nice overview, and it's about the exposure of the colonic mucosa, and we have no false positive results in that area. So what could be a good workflow then? And this was my first day with the cat eye system, and it's about the detection and characterization of lesions, as it was discussed before. And if you use the balloon, then you can center very easily like this lesion in front of you, and it's about detection, but immediately characterization like this adenoma. Or we're coming back now in the sigmoid again, and here we have an hyperplastic lesion, and you can make the interpretation, as Emmanuel said, with PIT pattern type 2, but also the computer is helping you saying that this is hyperplastic, or maybe better, it's non-dysplastic. And then it's very easy to use these cold snaring, as we have seen before. You just center, and the 6 o'clock position is the most ideal position to do your resection. But there's also beauty of the system, and here you see a differential diagnosis which can be made. This is a patient with a serrated polyposis syndrome, and he came several times, and here we see the serrated lesion. if the lesion becomes larger, then you see that the squares are kind of flickering around, but they show you that there's something you should pay attention. But with serrated lesions, as you know, there are some which have dysplasia and some which doesn't have. And here the computer is indicating that this is a neoplastic lesion. So there might be some dysplasia inside. And now by turning the endoscope to the second lesion here, again, the computer is telling you, or the artificial intelligence, that this is a neoplastic lesion. However, if you see now the little dots here, this was from a former resection. I placed the clip here, and these are just some hyperplastic areas, which are also correctly indicated. Then we move on to the next video. And here I did not switch on the cat eye, just to give you some seconds to get the clip. Now I switch on cat eye. Now here we are in the cecum. And if you now go very close to that area, then all of a sudden you will see here that in the center we have a depression and we have non-structural pit pattern 5. And this was an early cancer which could be diagnosed with this technology, even with your naked eye, but the indicator that this small lesion is neoplastic was something which was guided by artificial intelligence called cat eye. What are the diagnostic challenges? Sometimes, and I will show you some data in a second, we are quicker with the human eye identifying that lesion, and then the computer comes and shows you that there's a lesion. And also sometimes for the computer, it's difficult to make a right delineation of the lesion. It's more an indication that here is a lesion and you still need your eye to make the right judgment. Here, another example of those flat lesions, serrated lesions. And you see here very nicely that there's a serration here, and it's also indicating that there might be no dysplasia inside, but at least in the right side of the colon, you have to remove those flat lesions. And here this flat lesion goes also more to the left side. So there might be some disadvantages, as I indicated right now, but there are also some some very positive point advantages. And here you see, this is a polyp. I come back even with the balloon and you have a nice overview, but you reduce slippery, but sometimes you still slip with your endoscope. And then only for a very few seconds, maybe milliseconds, there was a polyp seen, but the computer already has identified that polyp. And now coming back, you can nicely see the polyp, and that could be easily identified. And that was also adenomatous tissue. And then to be very recent, this is a case from yesterday. And just to show you how you attract your eye. So if you come back here and then you see that lesion, we all look on that lesion. Thomas, I think it's clear, it's a lipoma. We see the normal mucosa. And also the computer says this is hyperplastic or no dysplasia inside. So I come back, but I still look on that lesion. But all of a sudden on the right-hand side, there was another lesion which might have been missed because our attention was so much to the left-hand side towards the other lesion. So to give you some data of our evaluation, what we did so far, you see that we had a lot of patients now, 660, and we could increase the adenoma detection rate. It's not nicely displayed here, but coming from about 40% to 50% with cat eye only almost, and 63% if we combine cat eye and GI. There was also the possibility that the human eye detection before cat eye was more seen if you did not use the GI technology, because yet there you had more peristalsis. When there was the cat eye used in combination with GI, then the computer was almost as quick as the human eye. And we had also the big reduction of false positive results from 33 per colonoscopy by using cat eye alone, but combining cat eye and GI, it was only 14. So you see, there is, I think, something which favors the nice combination of cat-eye and GI. And we also evaluate the prediction of histology. And here you see that the sensitivity is not perfect. It's about 78%. Specificity is very good, almost 96%. And the accuracy, 88%. And the main disturbing factor are serrated adenomas because they have a surface which reminds very much to hypoplastic polyps. And also inflammation can induce adenomas, whereas only inflammation. But I think, and that I leave to the discussion later on, that we have to distinguish whether we are working on the right side of the colon, where we have to remove the polyps, or we are on the left side on the colon, where we have less serrated lesions. And that's why we can maybe in the future trust the computer. The last thing I'd like to show you is the endoscopic intervention. We have seen the resection of Ale and how difficult sometimes you can place your endoscope. Here I use the anchoring mechanism of the GI balloon. So the balloon is somehow over-insufflated, and then you get really a very nice position of your endoscope in front of your polyp. And also if you do the injection, you are not pushed back as normal. You see here, you still stay exactly at the same position. And this will speed up your procedure and also give you a nice overview here. This is a clear serrated lesion. I know Pradeep would do ESD, but I apologize from my side here. I think the snare is still the right thing, but here we all agree. And with a good safety margin, you see how well you can maneuver your endoscope just by having this anchoring mechanism of the balloon, which with again is behind the optics, so you cannot see it. And here also I would like to show you some data, what we already published at DDW 2020, showing that with the anchoring system, we have much less time to do resection. So we save some time, only 7 minutes compared to 10 minutes with polyps larger than 20 millimeter. And you see also that the adenoma detection rate went up from 40% to 54%. So to summarize, I think CADA is really increasing the adenoma detection rate compared to historical controls. CADA is eager to display polyps which are difficult to recognize for the human eye. However, I think the perfect match is the conjunction with GI, which is further increasing adenoma detection rate. Some of the data were not well displayed. I will kind of give you that slide again so you can download it. It's from 45% to 63%, and it's also reducing the false positive results. And CADA can already be used to predict histology with about 88% accuracy. However, we still have to struggle a little bit with the serrated adenomas and inflammatory changes. Thank you, Thomas, for listening.
Thank you very much, Ralph. I detected I have one companion in EMR suffering still.
Absolutely. So,
I think we have enough discussion later on. There are a lot of interesting questions. So let's see what the live demos do. Ale, how far are you? Is the polyp almost
so
cut?
Can you... So I'm on the anal side, as Pradeep said. This is very difficult, so I'm in unstable position with the scope, and I have a little bleeding from hemorrhoids. You see, trying to press with my cap to see where is the bleeding point. It's not that big, but it's complicating a little bit my resection, so it's probably here. Try to coagulate as much as possible. You see here, there is the vessel.
Ale?
Yeah?
Do you sometimes, when the position is a little bit difficult, do you use a colleague for a third hand? Is that...
Not that much.
Not much, okay.
So you see, I'm trying to find the right plane at the anal level. There is still some bleeding here. They need to be controlled well.
So when you do hemostasis, do you change the current?
Yeah, we switch it to soft cog, but Right now, you see, I am in an area where everything is bleeding. You see that little vessel over here? So I take the opportunity of having the needle ready to control the bleeding, you see?
But that looks much better now.
Okay.
So good, Ale, I think
okay.
It will take a little while.
Yeah,
so
I need about 15 minutes.
We go to Pradeep.
So I think you can proceed.
And then come back for the final cut.
Okay, that would be great.
Okay, thanks very much. So we now change to the Portsmouth endoscopy unit. Pradeep Bhandari is also having a polyp patient, right, Pradeep?
Hi, welcome to Portsmouth, guys. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Excellent. Thank you. Welcome to Portsmouth. It's nice to join this fantastic event. We have lots of people to thank, but also patients to treat. So I'll move on. I'll introduce my team. I've got two fellows, Mo and Ijaz. Say hello, guys. And we got all our beautiful nurses here. Say hello. And my colleague, Shamila, behind me. Say hello. And we have a patient advocate behind me. Andrea, say hello. So we have this patient who's been referred to us who had a previous colonoscopy done in another center. And they suspected that there might be a couple of small polyps which they could not remove because the bowel prep was not perfect. So it's been sent to us to assess the colon properly and decide what to do. So my colleagues have been very good. They just got to the cecum. And straight away, you can see that the bowel prep is good. What I'll do is, first thing, to just switch off the CAD eye and see what we can see without the CAD eye, and then we'll see with the CAD eye. Because I know that Professor Roche is a randomized control man. He doesn't believe anything without an RCT. This is not an RCT, but it's a self-control. So if anybody sees any more polyps, please shout out among the faculty. Any more polyps? Thomas, has anyone seen any more polyps? Or all our faculty gone for coffee?
Well, what about this elevation on the right side?
There?
This one.
There?
Yes.
Yes? Well done. Is that Thomas?
Yes.
Oh, good. I believe your eyes, Thomas, still. Good. I'll show you. Let's assess this. It's definitely polypoid. And Thomas has picked up a very important point. So it looks polyp-like, and we would like to do a cold snare, hot snare. We can debate that. But before we do that, let's see what LCI shows. And this is now, I'll activate our detection system. It shows potentially there's a polyp there. So let us put on BLI. BLI is calling it hyperplastic polyp. Now, my own view is I have very, very good colleagues, Thomas, but I still haven't trained my fellow properly. So when he's sucking, he sucks full in or out. There's no in between. And that's, I think, what he's done. My fellow has sucked this mucosa, created a pseudopolyp. And this is not a hyperplastic polyp, and this is not an adenoma. And I can show you by getting a bit closer. You look at that. The surface pattern and vessel pattern of the two tissue is exactly the same. There's no difference.
Pradeep?
So, yes?
That's a very long-lasting polyp due to suction, isn't it? Wouldn't that convince you of the opposite? So it could still be a serrated?
I doubt. I think this is a suction artifact. Thomas, look carefully. You see that red rim around it?
Yeah, my fellow has
probably sucked.
I see that. But what about acetic acid? Something simple?
But I might be wrong, so maybe we will biopsy it. But let's see what other polyps we missed. So if I put LCI, it's immediately found as another polyp. Now, this I believe, they're definitely polyps. Let me put BLI, immediately neoplastic. So, Thomas, would you agree that this is a neoplastic polyp?
Yes, even without artificial intelligence.
I agree. For this polyp, I think all of us should be able to make that diagnosis. So why don't I resect this, Thomas, before I show any more polyps?
Okay.
So maybe what would you recommend, Thomas? Cold snare, cold polypectomy, or lift and resect? What would you suggest?
If you don't want to be totally outdated, you have to do cold snaring.
Cold snare. Okay. I agree. And what about this? I just missed this.
Pradeep, you won't be able to join any discussion.
Yeah.
This takes a long time.
You're right. So let me just see what this is. That's the power of the technology, is that we find now there are about big polyp all the way around there. Okay, why don't I resect this quickly, guys? So why don't we do cold polypectomy? Can I have a 7 millimeter cold snare? I think Professor Apici showed already. Let's put this down. Would you inject, Thomas, or would you just do a straight polypectomy without injection?
Quick and dirty, no injection.
I agree.
It looks a bit messy at the beginning, but then it straightens out.
I know that Ali has already showed. I'll quickly talk through. Before I resect, I fire a water jet to assess where the gravity is, because if the tissue flies away, it will fly into that puddle of water that I just fired. So I know where my gravity is. Then I deflate the colon. So that reduces the risk of polyp tissue flying away after resection. It also increases the chance of me catching normal mucosa around it. So this is the cross snare zero, 7 millimeter open, please. Okay, I'll try to see if I can catch both of these together. Okay, might be a bit tricky to catch both together. Okay. Maybe somebody could hold my endoscope there. Okay, don't close. Okay, just close slowly. Yeah, don't go through. So what I like is, I like to strangle the polyp for about 20 seconds. Just, can you blanch it? Yeah, just blanch it. Don't go through, but just close tighter. So I just strangle for 20 seconds before I go through. I feel that reduces the risk of, it reduces the bleeding. Doesn't take it away, but reduces. So go, because adenomas do bleed, okay? Slowly go through now, please. Go through all the way. Good, thank you. You see that? We got that, but there's a residual polyp there. Let me suck this before this flies away. So we have a trap attached already. I'll suck that tissue. And there's a little bit of residual adenoma there. I'll take that out as well. The wall is deflated without tension. Polyp doesn't fly away. Bit of strangling reduces the risk of oozing. Very important to assess the margins now to make sure we take away everything. Otherwise, the recurrence rate of cold polypectomy will go up. Open, please. You fully open? Okay, let's go in. Oh, it wants to twist, okay? You want to twist? I'll twist. Okay, slowly. Hold the scope there, please. I'll take a bigger bite. Slowly close there, please. Yeah, okay. Gently, don't go through. It's blanching. Just let it blanch for about a few seconds. And then I'll deflate. And now go through, please. It cuts really nicely. There is no tagging. There's no pulling. It's just really beautiful snare for cold snaring. Okay, that's it. You see very little oozing and bleeding. So now I come to this Thomas, we weren't prepared for this. Let's have a look at this. Okay, let's put BLI or LCI shows this really well. Now this, I think, would be good one for a cold EMR. Although adenomas and cold EMR is not a great idea, but there's a lot of cold wave coming from Australia, where everything is cold. I personally, what do you think, Thomas?
Don't you think this is could be a serrated, and that's especially suitable?
Yeah. So let's
well, at least
assess.
At least it's very flat, and
so I think it's quite possible that this could be a serrated lesion. Let me get closer. Yeah, you're right, Thomas. When we get close to it, you can see there's got almost hexagonal pits. So that's quite suggestive of serrated, but there might be dysplastic component in it. I think it's a combination of SSP with some dysplasia. But issue is the extent of it. So I would like to inject this, please. Let's inject. Yeah. Okay. So we're going to use this 7mm Manta needle from Fujifilm again. Injection. So the tricky bit is, where do I inject first? I don't want to lose this. But at the same time, I feel that if we put a little bit of indigo carmine underneath this, it will become a lot easier to detect this polyp. And if you amongst the panel could debate whether we do cold EMR, hot EMR, ESD, and let me know, and I'll just inject needle out.
Pradeep?
Yeah?
Do you usually switch off artificial intelligence during intervention?
Absolutely. Good you reminded me. I got so carried away. That's a very good practice, guys. Thomas made a very important point. When we're using AI, find your polyp, characterize your polyp, switch off, and then do your therapeutic work. So let's inject at okay, hold the scope.
What you can also observe with Pradeep is that he has this tendency to put everything at 6 o'clock, which is very important for resection.
Very important. That's very... Yeah. Okay, stop. It's a very nice needle, one single prick. So I feel, Thomas, when... Needle back. When there is no evidence of invasion, I like to inject in the middle of the polyp, achieve a big lift, needle out, so that we don't keep poking. Inject.
Yeah, that's one of the religious beliefs that you should not inject into the middle of a polyp.
I know that that was a religion and a theory, but you have to depend on your assessment skills. If you're not happy, then please don't inject. You have to be sure that it's not invasive. So what I'll do is maybe a 15mm snare or a 20mm. What do you think?
Hot or cold?
You tell me. I feel tempted to go cold here.
Yeah.
You agree?
Yeah. Well, I can only cite my predecessor, Nipsahendra, who said not too greedy. So I used to use somewhat smaller snares. So no 20s.
A small snare.
10 or 15 or whatever.
A 10 millimeter cold as well.
No, there's a 12 millimeter cold.
Oh.
There's a 12 cold.
12 cold. Okay, let's have 12 cold. I have a hybrid snare. Let me see what this hybrid snare does. But otherwise, we have a 12 cold that we could use. But hybrid just gives you that added advantage of switching over if needed. Okay, open please.
So hybrid means in case you get stuck with the cold resection, you can apply current.
Yeah. Now, although this is quite a big snare and I can potentially take the entire polyp, but because I've decided to do cold, I'm not going to take the whole polyp because we will get stuck and then we will have to use hot. So if we decided to do cold, please don't be too greedy. Just take small bites. Okay, start closing that. Go, go, go. Yeah. Okay, slowly, slowly. And go through slowly. Thank you. Okay. So what is that? So we've already decided to do cold, so there's no point doing too big a bite. So you see this nice tuft of tissue, some mucosal tissue, which is normal. We expect that. Open again a bit. Just stop there. Okay, okay. I said not to be greedy, but Thomas, I feel like I want to be greedy.
This is not greedy, and,
I'll try to take this. Sorry. Close, please. It's just too tempting for me not to take the entire thing. Now, I might get stuck. It might be too much. But let's see. Can you go through? Or is it too much?
No, I can go through.
Okay, let's try. Okay, so my colleague's judgment went wrong. We were too greedy. The cold snare will not go through. It won't have cold cutting. So we have two choices. I open the snare and I catch it again and take a smaller bite and take it in two pieces. But the tissue is traumatized, there will be oozing, there will be distortion. Or if you have a luxury of this hybrid snare and a good lift and injection, you don't need to worry. I just switch over. So now because you close tight, don't do anything. It will just go through. Yeah? And I just press the button on the diathermy pedal now, and it will, there we go. Just goes through immediately. So nice, clean cut, no need to release, no need to tag, no need to push. It gives you very nice, clean cut. So let me just flush this away so that we can see. Okay, nice. Okay. Now, important thing is flush and see what's left and what more needs removing. Okay.
So, Pradeep, although we know about the studies from Australia, but don't you think it would be much more faster just injecting and then placing the snare and resecting the lesion? You haven't seen the video of Ralph before, but it was a large lesion as well, and he just injected, placed the snare and cut it around, and it was nice, it was fast. Do we have to adapt according to the Australian way now in Europe as well and in UK?
Yeah, no, I mean, for this kind of polyp, cold EMR was perfect technique. It's just that I managed to catch too much tissue, so we couldn't go through cold, so we had to switch, and luxury that we had hybrid snare, so I could connect and take it off. But otherwise, you just disengage and catch it again and take smaller bites, and it will go through. So I've now got a little bit of tissue left at the edge. I want the clean edge, so open, please.
Pradeep?
Yeah?
We're going to watch one more margin resection, and then we probably go on. Is that okay with you?
Okay, sure. Close, please. Yeah, and go through. Okay. And we just got this satellite lesion. Nick, open. I think there'll be a lot of satellite lesions around here. I'll try. It won't take both of them. Come on. You can. Okay, close, please. Yeah, go through. Excellent. So I think we managed to get it all. You see why we don't get bleeding is because this submucosal vessel, you see there? We haven't traumatized it. Because these snares cut so superficially, we don't traumatize these vessels, so there's no oozing. The risk of delayed bleeding, it doesn't exist because the vessel is intact.
Okay,
so
Pradeep.
I've done this. I need to just have a quick look, Thomas, in case there's anything else. Quickly, before you go, just give me 30 seconds for a quick assessment. I put LCI, see if it shows us anything else. Oh, I put this off. So LCI is showing me, Thomas, there's something at the top.
Oh, I'm afraid there is a lot of polyp material
yes.
left, huh?
This is another very large adenoma there on the top. Oh, okay. So.
Okay.
So I've got a job to do, Thomas.
Pradeep, good luck with that. Thank you very much for this very didactic demonstration how to do cold snaring and what the difficulties could be, and we'll discuss this in the next round. Before we go to the debate, I think we have a look to Milano. So here we are in the blue Japanese space. You see the very careful dissection, small bursts. And it's always important to go back a little bit to get the overview and orientation. Ah, that seems to be pretty far. Close to the final cut. And it's important to expand the submucosal space to be sure that even if the rectal wall is thick, to be sure not to get too deep. Again, nice current, very little bleeding. It's close to the end. And you see, never cut too deeply or too quickly, very cautiously, slowly. Anything which looks elegant is usually also effective and safe. You see the polyp giving in.
So you told us in your practice in Hamburg, you would have maybe preferred EMR instead of ESD. Your technique, would it have been just injection and then placing a 20 millimeter snare or maybe piecemeal with a 10 to 50 millimeter snare and then in retroflexed mode, or maybe better from the normal side? What would be your approach to this type of lesion?
We take smaller monofilament snares, 10 or 15, depending. And you can, with some practice, you can resect polyps at the anal verge, even including cutaneous part. So that's not really a big problem. You might need a third hand that the instrument is stabilized and you can safely work. But I think it's possible. Okay, I think we have to sort of go to the next point. So maybe we can at the end see how far Ale is, if he can't join our discussion. And we'll go to the next point, the debate. How will artificial intelligence shape colonoscopy? Ralf, I've seen one of your videos when you showed the seeming disadvantage of large polyps, and there were several small frames. So could it be that the systems, or most of the systems, were trained in small polyps? So when you have a large one, they divide it into a few small ones?
Absolutely, Thomas. As you know, there's deep analysis, and it's about to find the small and flat lesions. And that is how the system is trained. However, if you get your square, you still can use your naked eye to make the right delineation. And if the lesion is very big, then it's often very easy to identify it by yourself.
Right. Okay, so this is for next generation AI for delineation. Emmanuel, you were speaking about training. But when you look at the artificial intelligence, is that necessary? Or you just switch the machine and you don't have to fiddle around with the pit patterns and the five different classifications and waste your time in training?
It's a very nice question. My feeling is that using artificial intelligence, using CADA, is very easy, very simple. It's not really training. It's just knowing the few tricks to get to give the system the best chances to work optimally. But it's not real training. It's just like we've seen knowing when to switch it on, switch it off, etc., making the right position. There are so much things to be done, I think, to use it on bigger lesions, bigger polyps, after resection, after injection. Maybe just simple question, how much mucosa did you see during colonoscopy? This is very important to know. If we can speed up with artificial intelligence, it means also that we can quantify the percentage of mucosa that we've seen and make sure that we don't leave an area, a wide area, unrecognized. So I think there are plenty of questions to be answered, but the how to use artificial intelligence CADA with small polyps, it's very, I think, very easy to do.
That's an interesting interesting issue you brought up, the quantification of the colonic mucosa. So isn't that a difficult IT task because you don't have a real gold standard? What's your concept how this could be done?
I'm not. I don't know exactly about this. Probably it's a combination of different systems. We need also to learn from other colleagues from radiology, etc. They could develop, for instance, systems to guide pulmonologists in the bronchial tree, combining CT images and endoscopy guidance systems. Maybe there are things that need to be conceived like this. I don't know. Things that look simple when we ask engineers how it could work, just getting the distance to a polyp or the size of a polyp, it looks very easy to ask, but very complicated to have an answer. So I leave it to the engineers. I don't know if Ralf or Helmut have different ideas, opinions. I think there are probably things that are on the way that we'll see quite soon, but I haven't seen something really efficient for the moment on quantification.
Polyp size is a very good point because we don't have reliable measurements. So Helmut, do you know of any technique? So how is it developing? Why can't we simply measure polyp size by AI or by any computerized system?
Yeah, thank you, Thomas. So it's a very good point, but the problem is always the distance. So the distance is, even for image interpretation in general, even for our own eyes, when it's only 1 millimeter apart for the computer, it makes such a huge difference. However, in China, for example, there is one group who's already developing a system, also a system which is assessing already how much of the colonic mucosa we have already seen. It's called EndoAngel. And this system in a preliminary study already works very well. However, this is not developed by a big company, but this is from a university side. But I guess indeed we can feel a lot. If you're in doubt of the size of a polyp, although, and if you're using an iPhone, for example, you can already use a measurement of this one as well. Surprisingly, it seems to work not that bad. But I'm pretty sure that in the near future, we'll also learn a lot from the big endoscopy companies, specifically even Fujifilm.
Yeah, the iPhone measurement is often cited when we speak about that. But obviously, you don't bring the iPhone into the scope whatsoever. Pradeep?
Hi. So I just wanted to update. We managed to remove that entire polyp. Done, and we put some pure fat, so I don't need to do the clipping. But coming to your point about sizing, I think all this development about characterization and optical diagnosis will still be of no big benefit if we don't have sizing. And I think that's when we can introduce resect and discard. And we've been doing some work about sizing, and it seems to be working. But as Helmut was alluding, the crucial thing is how to position yourself from the polyp. The distance has to be right. If the distance is not right, then you get all kinds of sizes. But the most important thing, Thomas, I wanted to highlight was that we picked up 5 experienced endoscopists and 5 fellows and created artificially sized, perfectly sized polyps. And we found that endoscopists were all over the place in sizing. We are not very good in estimating size.
That's right. So the small ones are overestimated and the big ones are underestimated and all that kind of stuff.
Absolutely.
But okay, so again, to the clinical application of artificial intelligence, let's ask Evelyn. Evelyn, you are coming from a high evidence country. You do a lot of fantastic studies. So when you see the polyp detection rates, and on the other hand, the polyp differentiation. So what is your feeling? Is it just another device to find more polyps? And how important will the differentiation be in terms of consequences?
Yes. So first of all, I think detection definitely can be aided by such techniques. As it's going to be in the endoscope and quite easy to use, I think it would be very easy to just put it on the background. So I think it will become implemented in daily practice. However, it should not have too many false positives. I think as an endoscopist, you still should be very good. And it already was a little bit discussed. I think if you don't bring the polyp into sight, you won't see the polyp. And although the example of Ralph was quite nice, that if you pass quickly by, you might be alarmed by the AI system that you should go back because you passed the polyp. But of course, in fact, your technique should be so good that you see the polyp because you move slowly, right? So still, we have to help the computer to see the polyp. So I definitely also think in future we need computers to tell us whether we do see all the mucosal surface or whether we skip areas. So that's on one side for the characterization. We've been discussing a lot on like, let's say, mostly early polyps or relatively small polyps. But I think there's going to be another big application, which is going to be for the early cancers, so early invasive lesions, because we definitely need good help there to be able to identify and diagnose those lesions accurately to decide which therapy will be useful and necessary. Because at the moment, we perform more and more, you know, full thickness resections, ESDs, all kinds of techniques that might be quite challenging. But we need to know who needs those techniques and who doesn't. So although I think it's going to be much more challenging than diagnosing the smaller lesions, I think it is important. And again, also here, it's going to be very important that the computer sees all the surface. So indeed, the surface is clean. But if it's a large lesion, we should also look at the backside of the fold, let's say. So still, I think endoscopic technique of the endoscopist will remain crucial.
Okay. If we go to differential diagnosis, I have a very important question for you, because for all of you, because, you know, we have been hearing for, I think, 12 years that the human intelligence has a 90-something% accuracy in differentiating polyps and you could do discard. But in reality, nobody does it. Everybody sends it to the histopathologist for fear of legal, etc. So why should AI be different, even if it's perfect? Who wants to get into the slippery area? Pradeep?
So,
and Ralph, then?
Thomas, you always pick up the slippery area. Somehow you always find them. You are right. There's so much evidence to say that optical diagnosis in expert hands work, but has never been implemented. Evelyn has done a trial. We've done a trial in UK. Both of them shows that outside of the academic centers, when you implement it, accuracy is really poor. And when I talk to the endoscopists who do a lot of colonoscopy, but not enthusiastic in research or optical diagnosis, they tell me that this is an unnecessary burden you're putting on me. This is pathologist's job. You want me to do a colonoscopy, now make a pathological decision and leave it? It's very difficult. So the endoscopists don't buy in. They need to buy into this concept either because they get rewarded financially, or they get rewarded in some sort of status you give them, or they made to feel more confident, more supported, more comfortable. And that's what AI would do, is that it will give them that confidence, support, and backup to say, you said hyperplastic, AI said hyperplastic, here is the documentation, picture was taken, and we don't need to do. So maybe I think AI will change it.
I think Ralph wanted to tell something. So what do we need that we can say, oh, it's the machine, it's not the pathologist, it's the machine?
Yes, Thomas, so we can look back maybe 10 years ago, and there we discussed to have an adenoma detection rate above 20%. Now we are discussing adenoma detection rates about 50%, 60% now in combining GI and CAT eye. I think the future research is about the meaning of those lesions. And I'm sure that 20 or 30% of those lesions you can leave in place because they will not lead to any colon cancer. And by finding more and more lesions, we have to better differentiate in the future. And there I'm sure that the CAT eye or any computer algorithm, which is always standardized, will be of great help.
Okay. Yeah, Evelyn?
Yeah, I quite like the hypothesis. Of course, I think we all feel that probably all those tiny adenomas might not really result in a very high risk for the patients to have a cancer later on. On the other hand, we hope not to do too many endoscopies, right? So I would rather have my colonoscopy done by somebody who finds, we detect any tiny adenoma and takes it out, but also detects my larger, very flat lesions and my other lesions. And then I wouldn't like another colonoscopy if they're all out for at least 10 years. So so it's quite interesting as a topic. What I think is the real answer to your question, Thomas, about the change of AI is that we get rid of the inter-observer variability, because we know that experts are very good in making an optical diagnosis. And when you train daily practice gastroenterologists, some do great, but others are less interested or less good or less whatever. They don't do so well. And if we have a computer helping us there, they might feel more confident, they might listen. And in the end, like was said, I think it will be ideal if the computer helps us with all those things, also like measuring the size, because we have then an accurate size measurement, and also helping us write the report, because we don't like all the administrative work either. And if the computer sees where the polyp is and what it is and whether we treated it or not, I don't have to type that all. So I think a lot of space there.
Well, guys, you are kind of avoiding the answer, which probably has to be avoided. But Evelyn or Emmanuel, would you, if you have a colonoscopy and somebody removes, I don't know, 5 small polyps, would you like that the colonoscopist throws them away and doesn't send them to the histopathologist? Yes? Emmanuel? Or just in case, let's send it to the histopathologist.
Yeah, I wouldn't be too frightened if we have data, if we have solid data showing that, and I'm sure it works, showing that CAT eye has excellent sensitivity, specificity, well, we rely on technology for lots of things in our daily lives, so why not for this one? But we need data, and I fully agree with Evelyn that we need finally networks. It's horizontal networks or flows of information from the detection to characterization, then to report, then to get the pathological report from the patient. But all of this connected on a patient's file, and we try to do this at the level of the French Society of Digestive Endoscopy to have the same report for everybody and get more data. We are not there yet, but we are working on this idea. And I'm hearing you, if we could share all of our preliminary experiences, I've seen the data presented by Ralph. It's very impressive. But if we could do this at a European level and then go very quickly with thousands and thousands of patients to give the exact numbers of accuracy on a large databases, then of course I would be okay to have a colonoscopy and a prediction relying only on CADI analysis and not no more on pathological report. But this needs to be supported scientifically.
Good. That was a very nice conclusion. So I like your hypothesis. If you have artificial intelligence drive your car, you also agree that artificial intelligence has the endoscopist throwing your polyps away. Okay. Good. So we are almost at the end. We have a short break. And I thank you very, very much for the discussion. And after the break, we'll go to the Amsterdam studio with Evelyn.
Fujifilm is a pioneer in diagnostic imaging. With over 70 years of expertise, we put cutting-edge tools in our customers' hands so patients get excellent results. Now we introduce Eluxio Ultra. Eluxio Ultra enhances your existing Eluxio platform by incorporating CADI, our powerful AI technology. With CADI, Eluxio Ultra is one of the first endoscopy solutions to detect and characterize lesions in real time, delivering our most powerful, complete, and comprehensive package for endoscopists. Eluxio Ultra will accommodate a range of future tools and technologies as they evolve, so our best endoscopy system for your patients today will remain so tomorrow. Human instinct plus artificial intelligence equals Eluxio Ultra, now available for your practice.
Hello from Amsterdam, indeed. I'm happy to moderate the second part of this this excellent webinar. And as a first action, I would like to go to the team of Pratip Bhandari back again at the Queen Alexandra Hospital in Portsmouth. And before we will do that, we will see a video of the mouth guard from Fujifilm.
The outbreak of COVID-19 has slowed down some medical treatments. 10% of the healthcare professionals are COVID-19 positive in Western countries. Endoscopy exams are being reduced in capacity or postponed, 54%, due to the lack of PPE protection devices. At Fujifilm, following long research and testing, we've developed a PPE device to reduce droplet spread, the B1 droplet reduction mouthpiece. Our study showed that droplets from patients might be a serious threat and a way of spreading the virus. We compared the traditional mouthpieces to our B1 mouthpiece, and the results are evident.
As an R&D engineer for endoscope system, I have two strong desires in the current situation. First is to provide patients with a safe and timely opportunity of appropriate endoscopic examination. The second is to mitigate healthcare workers' risk of infection. The product concept goal is to prevent the infection droplets from the patient during the procedure. Some of the design features are, first, the mouthpiece has two foam layers with three. The foam is designed to reduce the spread of droplets through the mouthpiece. The slits are designed to accommodate a different diameter endoscope. Second, the mouthpiece comes with a drape shield for covering the patient's face, and is designed to minimize the droplet spread from gap between patient mouth and mouthpiece.
COVID-19 is again dramatically spreading in the European countries, and therefore there is a very strong need for us in endoscopy to better protect our patients, but also to better protect ourselves. I strongly believe that the new personal protective equipment of Fujifilm might help us by reducing the amounts of droplets during endoscopy procedures.
At Fujifilm, we are committed to improving technologies that support global efforts to confront the COVID-19 pandemic. We will never stop innovating for a healthier world. Fujifilm, value from innovation.
Thank you very much. So this was a very interesting video, I think, on a new future that we might discuss in the later debate. So now I hope we are able to move to the unit of Professor Bhandari in Portsmouth.
I can update you with our last patient, that large polyp that we saw at the end. We removed that, we lifted and removed that with a 20 millimeter monofilament snap in one bite, and that went very well. So my question to Evelyn would be, Evelyn, we removed one large 20 millimeter, one another 15 millimeter, right? So two at least large polyps in right colon. What would you suggest we should be doing to reduce the risk of delayed bleeding and perforation in this setting?
Well, I saw you perform the polypectomies. They were all done cold, right?
So I did one cold, and that big one we did hot.
Oh, you did hot. Okay. So, if the patient does not have any risk factors for delayed bleeding, I would probably leave it as it is. The resection scars looked very nice. We know after cold snaring, even piecemeal, that the risk of late bleeding is very small, nearly zero. After hot snaring, of course, there's a little higher risk, especially if lesions are right-sided and the patients are older. And of course, especially if the patient is using anticoagulants or antiplatelet therapy. If there's none of such risk factors as antiplatelet or anticoagulants, and the procedure went well, it didn't look very deep, I probably would leave it as it is.
Yeah. Well, because there's a lot of trend nowadays about clipping and closing. So I feel that if it's a very big defect, sometimes if people don't do a lot of clipping, they can potentially do some harm while clipping rather than do any good to the patient. So I'm glad that you're very pragmatic about it. Raf, what is your view on that?
So if you look back 2 years ago, then the meta-analysis showed that clipping was not in favor and you could leave it. But the most recent one again showed that if you have a defect of 2 centimeters and if you did hot snaring, then clipping might be advantageous. However, you have to know how to do it, as you said. So it depends whether you had hot snaring or cold snaring.
I agree. And Helmut, what do you think? Would you use anything other than clipping, like something like Purostat, hemospray, anything like that?
Yeah, thank you, Pradeep. And I totally agree with Ralph and you as well. And what we have also learned from the most recent paper in gastroenterology, that clipping is effective, but only when there is a complete closure of the defect, otherwise not. So indeed, we both prefer even application of Purastat. And you have already mentioned that even in the defect before, you have applied Purastat. And I feel this is a very good new agent because it really achieves an extra relief for us and our patients as well.
Excellent.
Although I really like this discussion, we will definitely go on with the debate. Professor Ripici is asking to come back to Milan to his case. So let's do that first and then get back to the discussions we are having. So Alessandro, you're back.
Hey, Evelyn, I don't know if you can hear my voice.
Yes, we can.
Okay, just in case you cannot hear my voice, please, Ale. Mettimi come primo. No, la... Ok. So was... Loro non vedono niente. Ok.
We can hear you, Ale.
Okay, it was very challenging ESD.
Yes.
Can you see how many vessels
here? Those are indeed impressive. Can you get a bit closer there? Close to the anal verge?
So these are hemorrhoidal vessels. That's hemorrhoidal plexus there, isn't it?
This is the anal side.
That's hemorrhoid.
Wow.
Okay. And now, pure stat.
So please explain what you're doing. Yeah.
Grazie. Ok, comincia. Aspetta, eh. Ok, let's go. Vai. I hope you can see Purastat now.
Yes, very nicely.
So, ready to be used, very easy to be used. Technically, no contraindication. I think Pradeep can add the comments. Is the top expert in the world. It's a peptide that once comes in contact with the surface, create a nice layer protecting against bleeding. Bye. Okay, stop. It's also effective for controlling tiny oozing bleeding. Bye.
Will you inform me?
And trying to cover the entire surface has been treated. Okay, go here. Okay. Okay. So it's like painting. Okay. I think I covered everything. At this point, don't wash. You don't need to wash. Just suck air. So there are animal studies showing that this layer, protective layer, will remain until 24, 80 hours. So we have a preliminary data from studies from Pradeep Bhandari from UK showing there is a significant reduction in delayed bleeding. We are conducting an European registry trying to understand what is the impact on a larger scale, on a larger number of procedures. And this is to show you the final appearance of Purastat also on the anal verge.
Okay, so Alessandro, do you hear me?
Okay, Evelyn, hope you have my audio. I'm not sure. I just will summarize.
Okay. Okay, thank you so much.
Was a very difficult, challenging ESD. We showed the anal side.
Yes.
We had many, many vessels, so we had to use coagraspers several times.
Yes.
And at the end, to protect the resected area from delayed bleeding, we used the Purastat, as we do when we do this large resection.
It was clear. Very nice. Very nice. It's very clear. We had heard you perfectly, but I think you do not hear
okay.
us.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank
you. See you later.
Ale. Thank you. So I think this was a very nice demonstration. Is Pradeep still in the group?
Can you come yes, in? I'm here.
So Pradeep, what I'm especially curious about is the special location. As you said, it looked like the hemorrhoidal plexus that he had been removing the polyp. But I'm also curious about the application of Purastat in that region, because how long should the Purastat be attached to the lesion? Because I can imagine that as a reflex, the patient will evacuate the Purastat. So I was just wondering whether you can comment on that.
No, very, very good question and a very important one. All I can say is that there's been animal data where they have used Purestat in pig's colon, and then after 5 days, they've sacrificed the pigs, and the pathologist could see Purestat gel in the pathology specimen at day 5. So that's one piece of data. Second piece of data, I have occasionally been had the opportunity to endoscope the patient after 24 hours for whatever reason, and we can see the gel on the base. So I might be needed in the endoscopy room, Evelyn, so I'm going to go in and join you there in 2 minutes.
That would be great. Thank you, Pradeep. So any comments from the other faculty members? So when we are discussing, I was actually being asked whether I was willing to clip that lesion of 50 millimeters in the ascending colon. Anybody else who wants to comment on that? Because I think there's quite a lot of data out there now, and actually even a meta-analysis. Anybody who wants to comment on that? Maybe Helmut?
Yeah, no, I think it was an excellent demonstration, honestly. And before we really had a lot of discussions, what about the best resection technique? I feel most important is to take the lesion totally out. It was a tubular villous adenoma. And Professor Ripici has done a fantastic job in order, you know, because I feel this is so impressive because, again, it was an incidental lesion. The procedure was only intended to show the effect of cat eye for detection of the lesion. And then suddenly, just before evacuation of the endoscope, there was this type of lesion. They switched to ESD in the late afternoon, and then they performed a fantastic ESD, with some handwritten remarks for all of us. And then finally, what about the control of the bleeding? And again, we have already discussed about the potential of Purestat. I think your question, is a patient evacuating this with the first air, is a very important one. I would agree. However, in our practice, we have also very good experience with the Purestat, and it seems that it's really absolutely working even at those challenging locations directly at the anal verge.
Okay, but then really clearly my question on the comparison between clipping such kind lesions or putting Purestat. I think Purestat is definitely less challenging. As you can see, it was very nicely and accurately applied, which is absolutely more easy, I think, than clipping lesion, right?
Yes, absolutely. And I feel even clipping in this location is not that easy. First, technically not that easy, but of course possible. But finally, even, you know, for the clips, they might result in some uncomfort feeling for the patient at this challenging location. So I feel clip is not the right thing for us to do. We can either leave it like it is, and then we hope for the best that there is no bleeding. But to gain this extra relief, I feel even specifically in those very challenging COVID-19 times now for all of us, we do not want to have the patient back in our endoscopy room. No. Yeah, we want to have a good feeling. And I feel specifically even in those very challenging COVID-19 times for all of us, I feel Purestat even results in this extra relief feeling.
Yeah. So I would like to ask Ralph, in which patients then, of course, I think we should focus on that, would you be willing to use Purestat? Because again, I think the application for an ESD, for example, I think the indication is quite clear to me, I think, although evidence we might still need. How about those right-sided lesions of up to 2 centimeters? Would you think the risk of the bleed would balance again against the time and the cost of the Purestat? Any ideas how would you do that in your practice?
So for large defects, we used for a while also hemospray, but that's not longer available in Germany. I've heard it comes back in Europe, but this is more used for acute bleeding. So for large defects after ESD, I think we have seen a very nice application. In the right colon or after resection, I still like the clips. If you are eager to use and to know how to use it, then you just close the defect, and then based on very solid data, you know that to reduce the risk of rebleeding significantly, and it's about only 1.6% after the closure of the defect.
Yeah. So was Ale in the group there as well? How would you do that in your practice, Ale? When would you use any prophylactic therapy and then which one? Or is Ale not alive there?
Not a human being, it's only a picture, no. I guess.
Okay, Emmanuel, please tell us your vision.
I think, yeah, Pulastat is very, very new, very exciting. I would like to know how it works exactly, finally. Is it, does it have also anti-fibrotic properties or anti-inflammatory properties, maybe neuronal nerves, chemical changing, etc.? It would be very nice to have this kind of translational studies, but for the moment, just using it in our daily practice, I think it all depends on the location of the ulcer, of the post-resection ulcer. I use it very much after papillectomy, endoscopic papillectomy, and in the colon, it's when we do not... After vater adenomas resection in the duodenum. And in the colon, I think I rely very much on clipping, but sometimes it's very difficult. And finally, I think that's the beauty of endoscopy also. We learn all the time, even things that we think that we master. I realized when I started POEM, for instance, procedures, that I was not that good at clipping. And with POEM, you want clips to be really well placed with optimal closure of the defect. And then it helped me after for other procedures. So maybe we need to think about our residents and maybe doing more live demos, live, etc.
Okay, thank you very much, Emmanuel. Although we just surprised Pradeep, he surprises me now. No, he doesn't. He's actually in his endoscopy suite now, and he's going to do the last live case for us.
What I want to show is the patient is where got this nice new mouth guard that Professor Newman just showed you us in the video. And you can see here that there's enough space between the mouth guard and the sheet, so patient doesn't feel claustrophobic, basically. Because the mouth guard's so big, my scope is nicely held, but there's no resistance, it's moving quite well. So if we could change to the scope view now, please. So this is the patient who's got history of anemia, had OGD and colon, everything was fine, but what they found was she has got GAVE. I guess you got the scope view now, Evelyn, is that right?
Yes, definitely.
You can see that patient has got GAVE, and that probably explains why she was becoming anemic. Now, there's a lot of work going on in UK. Some centers are using just Purestat on its own for this. We still do APC ablation or RFA ablation. I'm not sure what our colleagues in Europe are doing, whether you use APC or RFA ablation for this. Do you want to ask your colleagues? I'm just trying to use a hybrid APC, if it works, to see if we can use hybrid APC.
Yes, so
stomach tissue can be very, very tough here. And getting a lift can be very, very difficult.
Yes.
As you can see, we got a bit of lift there. So I will ablate this. I'm using a pulsed APC mode. And having this lift underneath gives me the confidence to do really good ablation.
Okay, so this is indeed how you always do it, Pradeep? You always inject before you APC for GAVE?
Not always, but more recently, ever since the hybrid APC, we felt that it increases the safety and allows us to do more aggressive ablation. So we found that we're doing less and less sessions for these patients now as compared to before when we were not injecting.
Okay, interesting.
We do this in the colon as well, and again, I find that it's a lot safer to inject and ablate. We're doing less sessions. The only issue is that healing after APC, like in radiation proctitis, can be a real challenge. And then you need to think what you're going to do to promote healing. Oop. You see the lift sometimes can be a bit random. And we got to be careful that we don't lift too many unnecessary tissues.
Pradeep, may I ask, are you also using bent ligation for Gave syndrome?
That's a very good idea. It's been very well reported, but in my practice, I haven't done. Do you do that?
Oh, yeah, indeed. So we have very good experience with bent ligation because what we have learned from the previous publications indeed is that from the Gave, the vessels are rising from the deeper layer. So sometimes it might become challenging for APC really to, you know, to address the correct vessels, namely the deeper ones.
Yeah.
And with bent ligation, it also yields in a very successful therapy. So there have been some very small comparison trials, but they mostly favor bent ligation. But I feel your demonstration is fantastic and even shows the effectiveness here of the hybrid system. And potentially you can even do now GPOM.
you don't have to use hybrid. I think APC on its own would be fine. But I feel the hybrid gives that added safety. And pulse mode in hybrid is quite effective in controlling it. I would have preferred to put a cap on because that gives him a lot more stability of the scope. So what we do now, we have a trial going on in UK about using Purastat on its own. But I am still using ablation and then we use Purastat. And the results have been really good.
Are you doing a trial on that as well? And the other one is also a trial? Because I think, indeed, what we would like to have is good data, right? Because I
yes,
think it's
absolutely.
Really
yeah. No, all this is part of the trial, Evelyn. You're absolutely right. We need good quality data and meaningful outcome to show that it makes a difference. So, yeah, we're collecting all the data in terms of clinical endpoints.
But it's a very interesting idea to use it as even as a primary treatment. I'm very curious for the results.
Yeah, I have four or five centers in UK who believe very strongly in that, and they just do that. So they've got a massive funding recently from NIHR to start a big national study. So hopefully we'll get very good quality data coming out soon. But till then, I am using this in radiation proctitis and in Gave after ablation. And one of the things in radiation proctitis, ablation is such a controversial thing. If you ablate, they get ulcers. The ulcers don't heal. Patient get a lot of pain and symptoms. But if we use Purastat after that, the healing has been really, really good. I prefer only to treat one half today, and the opposite half we're going to keep on the next session. So I think we've done the bottom half. So what we're going to do now is take some of the gas out, just do this bit, and then apply Purastat.
Yeah. So when will you bring the patient in for the other half then? How long?
So we generally about 2 to 3 months.
Okay. And is the other part healed then, or is it still a bit ulcerated?
Say that again. Oh, no, in 2 to 3 months, what we've noticed is if you bring back in 2 months, they used to be ulcerated, look very horrible. Now we have very good data showing that Purastat enhances healing. And we find no ulceration, a very nice, healthy scar. So can I have some Purastat, please? So what we'll do is take out excess gas. My patient is just under sedation, no propofol or anything else. So it's very, very important for us to deflate, make the patient comfortable. Yeah. And we can give a little bit of sedation if patient needs some. Yeah. So I'll just give a little bit of buscopan, guys, to open up and stop all these contractions in the stomach, please. Yes. Puristat? A bit of buscopan? It looks very gruesome, isn't it, this ablation business?
Yeah, gruesome.
You know, once you start doing these nice, clean procedures, you don't like these gruesome appearances, but outcome is quite good, though.
Yeah. Yeah, and if you see this, you understand your injection before. Huh?
Yeah.
So you're putting in the catheter now, I think?
Yeah, sorry. So Puristat comes ready-made, as Ali showed you before. There are some tricks and tips about Puristat is that because it is a gel, you have to understand your gravity and start on the anti-gravity side. You can see the gravity is there. So whatever I put will rush away on that side. So there's no point me starting there. If I start, it will start trickling there. Start, please. Yeah, keep going.
Yeah, that's an excellent demonstration. This is what I meant before with extra relief in these COVID-19 times. You know, no one of us wants to have this patient back with a bleeding. Yeah, and now just applying Puristat. And Pradeep, you're not applying that much, is it? So we learned from your publication that it looked very much, but it's not that much. It's just only a couple of mils what you're applying.
Exactly. So you need very, very small amount. You just need to touch but not touch. You have to be very, very close, but not really touching. Go there. And you see, you don't need to put too much. Stop, slow. And the nurses need to program themselves because they're generally quite quick in rushing it out. So just go there. Stop.
But I guess it comes in a fixed quantity?
It comes in 1 ml, 3 ml, and 5 ml syringes. So depending on how much you need, I'm using a 3 ml, and I've only used half of it. Now, because my colleagues in Manchester and up north believe that Puristat can work even without ablation, so I'll go with that theory and apply Puristat without ablation on the opposite side. The next time I can see what it looks like. Go there, please.
So will you use the 5 ml quantity then?
I honestly never felt the need for 5 ml. Stop.
But that's also because you're a very talented endoscopist and can exactly apply it in the right place, right? Directly.
Exactly. You need to be very careful, coordinated Evelyn. Act between the endoscopist
Evelyn,
and the nurse.
Evelyn, can you hear me?
Yes.
Evelyn.
Yes. Ale, yes, please.
Stop. I'm not sure that Pradeep is very talented, so don't go too much ahead with him. Yeah. No, otherwise, it's not Christmas yet. So Evelyn, I think he's doing a great demonstration, but it's time to move to next lecture with Helmut.
Here.
Okay.
No, because I know I'm scared that he will cover the entire mucosal surface of the stomach with the Puristat. It will take about a couple of hours. And
I have seen
Helmut with a nice tie now, so it's good to hear from him, you know?
Okay,
he presented himself without tie in the beginning, so.
Sorry, Pradeep, the boss is calling me. I have to leave you, Pradeep. Good luck. And see you in a minute, probably, in the debate.
Yeah, you can see that Puristat looks as good as Professor Newman's tie now. look how nice it's covered. Evelyn, if I come back here tomorrow, you will still see the residual gel in the base. So we know at least for 24 hours, I've seen a lot of cases where it stays. So I think this case is done. If anyone got any questions before I take the scope out,
but you can see nice case.
Room view again. I'll ask my fellow to give you the room view. Patient's very comfortable with this mouth guard. You can see it covers patient's fast asleep. Everything's working well. So I think this mouth guard can be a real good opportunity during this COVID times to make us all safe. So because initially I thought, oh my God, I'll feel claustrophobic in this, but I've got it myself. I've used it and it looks fine. Patients tolerate it really well. So I think there's no need to worry about that. It's a really fantastic little innovation.
Great. Thank you, Pradeep. This was a wonderful demonstration of several different issues in upper GI endoscopy. Yeah. Thanks so much.
Pleasure.
And we will indeed move on to the lecture of Professor Neumann now, who is going to discuss with us bleeding and bleeding prevention after resection. Helmut.
Yeah, thank you so much, Evelyn, and scusi capo for my faux pas, for not for wearing a tie, but so there is so much in our minds at the moment, and the tie is sometimes the smallest problem. So can you see my slides, hopefully?
Yes.
So it's a great pleasure. Again, thank you so much for having me. Thanks so much to Fujifilm for this invitation. Also, great honor participating in this Endoscopy on Air, the global platform here for endoscopy live streaming, and now to give a short talk about bleeding and bleeding prevention. And when we're discussing about bleeding, I think we have to identify that there are two different types of bleeding. The first one is the immediate bleeding, accounting for up to 20% of cases. And then we have delayed bleeding in approximately up to 9% of cases. Localization, we all know the stomach bleeds most, what I've experienced today in a procedure just before. And then the colon, very much the same like the esophagus. It is of doubt if really there is more bleeding for endoscopic submucosal dissection than for EMR. Honestly, I personally believe there is less bleeding mostly for ESD compared to EMR, because for ESD, we are able to identify the vessels before they are bleeding. And for EMR, what you can see in the videos below, well, we just catch the tissue and then we have good luck. Or like in those images, we have bad luck when we have resecting it, but we're not able to identify the vessel. So what we have learned from the publications that bleeding during resection occurs in up to 70% of cases. And of course, we have various techniques to stop the bleeding, including injection, including coagulation. We can use clips, or also what we have already intensively discussed today. And I want to highlight a little bit of this new agent as well in the presentation later on. We can use the new agent of Pura-STOT. So what are now the risk factors for intra-procedure bleeding and delayed bleeding after colonic EMR? And this was a large study published in Clinical Gastroenterology and Hepatology just a couple of years ago. And you can see the authors have included more than 1,000 lesions with a mean diameter of more than 35 millimeter in size. And you can see intra-procedure bleeding occurred in 11% of cases. And the risk factors were the lesion size, a Paris type 2A, slightly elevated or 1S lesions, tubular villus, and villus type of the adenoma. Delayed bleeding in this study accounting for approximately 6% of cases, and the risk factors identified were the proximal colon location and even intraprocedural bleeding. And I feel what is very important for us to learn from this study. And so far, we have not discussed about this before, but I want to show to you that even intra-procedure bleeding was associated with early recurrence of the disease in this very large study, including, again, more than 1,100 lesions. And even in this publication in Journal of Gastroenterology and Hepatology, there was an idea about the risk factors for perforation, but even delayed bleeding in gastric ESD. Again, over 1,000 lesions have been included, and you can see delayed bleeding occurred in approximately 5% of cases. Risk factors, higher age of greater than 80 years and a longer procedure time. But also in this publication, the rate of residual disease or recurrence after ESD was significantly higher in lesions with delayed bleeding. And you can see 5.4% compared to a little bit less than 1%. And I feel this is very important. And so far we have not discussed about this, but indeed we have two problems of the bleeding. Of course, the first one is the bleeding itself, but the second problem of bleeding is the higher rate of residual disease. So indeed, when we are not able to see anything because there is so much blood, of course, there might be some challenges for us to identify the residual disease, and then we are not able to remove it immediately. And then on the follow-up, we'll be able to see that there is a residual disease. So bleeding is really a problem in endoscopy, but not only the bleeding itself, but even that there is a high rate of residual disease. So the question then for us is, what can we do? So what can we do? And one answer is, I would say, well, first of all, we should choose the good equipment for the resection. And in the live procedures, what we have learned today, and again, they have been excellent demonstrations, real life in afternoon procedures. I'm highly impressed that even in the late afternoon, even in Milano or in Portsmouth, the procedures were very clean. So the patients were fantastically prepared, even in the late afternoon. So they have done a fantastic job for those very challenging procedures. But using a good snare, I feel, is sometimes really very important. And having a flexible snare. And again, endoscopy on air today is supported by Fujifilm, and Medwork is now part of the Fujifilm family, and they are using this so-called flex snare. It's a fully rotatable snare. You can see you can rotate it in 360 degrees. You can turn it right side, or even if you want, you can turn it left side. So for some specific indications, I feel a snare like this indeed might be very, very helpful, because you're able to position the snare right above the lesion, even though maybe you're not able to position the polyp at the 6 o'clock position. And even another snare I want to highlight shortly, because we haven't seen it today in the live demonstration, but I feel even this one is a very interesting one, because it's a special dedicated snare developed for flat lesions. And this is called the resection master of Medwork as well. And I feel sometimes in endoscopy, there might be the problem that we really have the very flat lesions. And resecting a lesion like this, maybe even here, it's at the rectus sigmoid junction, might become challenging, because you can see that after resection, you can nicely identify the lesion, but there is really no real elevation for a lesion like this. So should we use knife-assisted resection, or are there other options? And I feel one of those options, this might be the resection master, because you can see the snare here. And then it has a monofilament wire. So it's a very interesting snare. You can see it's here. It's a very stiff snare. You can push the snare in the tissue. And even though this is a very slightly elevated lesion to the mucosa, it is very, well, I do not want to say easy, but it's really easy to grasp the tissue and then to resect the lesion in one piece as well. Although, again, the location and even from the morphology, this might be a lesion. Otherwise, what might have become difficult to grasp with a normal snare. But after resection, you can see that the lesion is totally out and you have a good safety margin. And you can see the nice submucosa stained blue, because we have added some methylene blue to the injection solution. But again, what about hemostasis now? Of course, first one, we should avoid the bleeding, but sometimes it's not possible to avoid the bleeding. And there is now this new option providing an effective hemostasis and a better outcome of our patient. And this is Purastat. And this is all what you need. So Purastat comes with a pre-filled syringe here. And Professor Bhandari has already mentioned that you can use different vials, so up to 5 mL, but there are also smaller ones available. And there is a catheter. And for example, if you're using different types of clips from different companies or other equipment in endoscopy, we all know that there is always a small learning curve involved for the nurses and for the assistants. However, Purastat, I feel, can be applied by everyone, because you just need to push the here, and then, well, you can see it goes just the way through the catheter, and this is all, and the hemostasis is achieved. So there is no learning curve, and it's extremely easy to apply. So what is Puristat? And Professor Coron-Emmanuel, you have already asked, what is it now? What is this agent? And I want to highlight that this is a hemostat of synthetic peptides, which are able to self-assemble in contact with blood. And this is the idea of the Puristat. And it's a reason why Puristat is also extremely helpful, because it is very easily applied in order to gain hemostasis. And you can see Puristat indeed is a viscous agent. You can look through. Yeah, it's a transparent one. And the idea is that when there is a bleeding, you have to remove the blood as much as possible from the hemorrhagic side. And afterwards, you just apply the catheter and then you push, and then the hemostat is applied here, the Puristat, what we have seen in the live videos by Professor Bhandari just before, and then there is a complete hemostasis achieved. So Puristat, it causes a three-dimensional matrix when there is contact of Puristat and the blood, and this acts as an instant mechanical barrier. So we have a mechanical barrier of the Puristat agent, and this yields that the bleeding stops. So this is the principle of Puristat, and therefore it is so safe and so effective because it's so easy to use and to apply. So how long does it stay? And Evelyn, you have already asked about this. And Puristat, well, it may remain longer than 3 days, but we have already learned about the key point that Puristat may be present for up to 6 days at the defect site. And this has been shown in the preclinical animal model, what has already been discussed before. So this was a case from our unit just a couple of days ago, and this is a very distinct colorectal cancer, and this is, I feel, a problem because it was a Friday procedure, and the patient presented with anemia and blood, and it's an outpatient center, so the question is, what can you do in such a case? You can see CAT, of course, we have seen about it before, is identifying the lesion correctly. But then because it's a constant oozing bleeding, well, clipping in this location will not work because it's a tumorous tissue. Other agents, even injection, might only work for a couple of minutes. But of course, you can see that it's very easy to apply the Puristat here in this location, and then the bleeding stops. And again, we have had the follow-up of the patient, and indeed, the bleeding has stopped sufficiently, and the patient can go for the subsequent examinations. But I feel this is a real-time case showing even the potential of Puristat in a case where otherwise hemostatic agents might fail. The bleeding stops. Is it now effective in clinical trials? And Professor Repici has already mentioned our expert in this field is the group of Pradeep. So Professor Bhandari's group has already published excellent data in this field and published in high-rated journals like in the UEG journal in 2018. So you can see they have included various types of lesions in the esophagus, in the colon, stomach, and duodenum. Great. Very big lesion size of greater than 3 centimeters. Most of the 1/3 of the patients on antithrombotic therapy, but you can see that the Puristat was a very effective hemostat in most of those cases. And even what we have discussed before, the mean amount of this Puristat was not that much. So only 1.7 mils of the Puristat have been applied, although again, the lesion size was really very big and it only took approximately 1 minute to control the bleeding. And also a very exciting and new study just more recently published in Endoscopy by Professor Bhandari's group, over 100 patients undergoing ESD, and they have been randomized to a control group with diathermy to control the bleeding and a second group with Puristat. A follow-up was performed after 4 weeks, and you can see that there was a significant reduction of heat therapy for Puristat. And also, and I feel this is very exciting for us to recognize, the complete wound healing at the follow-up endoscopy after 4 weeks was noted in approximately 50% of cases with Puristat compared to only 1/4 of the control patients. So indeed, Pourastat might have a role in improving post-resection wound healing. And therefore, we are all very keen to learn even from the GAVE data of Professor Bhandari's group. So at the end, I just want to show you this, this polyp also from this week. And this is extra relief after endoscopic resection, how I call it. So this is a cecal polyp which has been removed. Of course, one could potentially apply clips, but there was a little bit of oozing, bleeding afterwards. The patient was on antithrombotic therapy because of an acute coronary stent as well. And then the question is, what can you do? And we can apply, as you can see, the Pourastat. We can paint. But also I want to show we are now applying a little bit more in order to show you that this is really a viscous solution. And also what is very important, we'll now deep dive in this solution in order to show you that this one is really absolutely transparent. So by using a little bit of magnification, now you can nicely see here, even through the Pourastat solution. So you can identify that there is no residual bleeding anymore and the bleeding has stopped completely. So gaining extra relief after endoscopic resection, I feel even for outpatients, this might be a new alternative, specifically even in those very challenging COVID-19 times. So I would say, in conclusion, we have seen the Pourastat. This is a new agent now to gain the bleeding control. It is transparent, very easy to use, and it's a synthetic agent, so we can apply it without any, for me, any known side effects. So it is easy to apply. We just use the syringe, we apply the Pourastat, and the bleeding has stopped. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Helmut, for this wonderful presentation. So I can clearly hear you are a fan of Pourastat. Maybe one of the other debaters has a question for you, but just alluding a little bit on the case of Pradeep. He told me that after one day, the Pourastat would still be attached to the lesion. Is that irrespective of eating or drinking, or let's say in a case of yours, the same? How does it only attach if you don't have things passing by, or is it really that solid? I'm just curious how it will look like.
So we have never done a follow-up endoscopy in our unit after application of Pourastat, but as soon as Pradeep is coming back to us, maybe he can answer it, because in his unit he is doing the follow-up endoscopies after even application. So we can only provide our clinical experience, and from the clinical experience there is no bleeding afterwards. So from the clinical experience, we would expect that the Pourastat definitely keeps the position, otherwise it would not work.
I can answer your question that there have been cases where we've gone in. It looks like almost a solidified discolored jelly, Evelyn, when you go back. It's a jelly on the surface, which is very sticky and difficult to pull it off if you go after 24 to 48 hours.
So even though the patient is, for example, has been drinking and eating some. Okay.
Yeah.
So Pradeep, sorry, Evelyn. You think it can be usable for preventing esophageal strictures when we do dilation, when we do removal of lesions? Is there any?
That's a very, very clever idea. I think if we have tried in few cases already where we've done very extensive esophageal resection. Because it promotes healing. There's a very good data in our randomized trial. We saw that it promotes healing. So it makes sense, but we just don't have enough data, Ali, to make a statement.
Okay.
More data.
I think there was a question from Raf, no?
That's true. Pradeep, I have a question. You showed very nicely how to use Pourastat, but I didn't understood if you do not have any defect, is that then any helpful, like in the GAVE syndrome where you did not do any APC and you just put on some Pourastat? I would guess that this will just washed out or went away much quicker than in an area where you really have a defect.
Yeah. Very, very important question. I completely agree with you, Raf. That's why in my practice, I ablate and use, but there are three centers up north in England who have some very good preliminary data of just using Purostat every 6 weeks. And they found regression of these vessels, reduction in transfusion rate and hospital admission rate. And based on that, NIHR has funded a big randomized trial in UK. So they're just starting a randomized trial. I'm impressed. I can't understand, but you know, that's the data. I haven't changed my practice. I have to say I still ablate and I use Purostat after because I think it enhances healing. Very, very, very good data on enhancement of healing.
So Pradeep or Helmut, is there any data on the use of Purostat in acute bleeding? So we just saw an example of Helmut where you saw that the bleeding was not going on, but that was a very small bleed from a minor vessel. Any other data on acute blood bleeding?
Very good. In our experience, we have used Purostat in a randomized trial, Evelyn, during ESD. So one arm was randomized to thermocoagulation during bleed. The second arm was randomized to only Purostat during bleed. And we categorized our bleeds into three different categories. Grade 1 was a simple profuse ooze. Grade 2 was a venous bleed. And grade 3 was arterial bleed. And what we found is in grade 1 and grade 2 bleeds, there was a 90% plus efficacy in Purostat controlling the bleed. In grade 3, the arterial bleed, I do not recommend because what we found was all Purostat does, it slows down the bleed. It doesn't stop. So you can use Purostat to just slow the bleed a little bit and it's transparent. So you can still see through it, but you still have to treat. So arterial bleed, it's not your choice of agent, but the other grade 1 and 2 is a very effective agent.
Okay, thank you so much. Regrettably, we have to go on to the last debate of today, which is a debate on COVID, actually. And also the endoscopy during times of going, of ups and downs of COVID, it was called. So, we have the chief of COVID amongst us, which is Alessandro. So I'm very curious to hear from you as a first commenter on how do you do it in your unit to prevent COVID transmission from patients to staff and from staff to patients?
Thanks, Evelyn. This is a good point. In general, we have collected a lot of data across the last 6 months, and the feeling is that endoscopy is a very safe place. So the number of patients that have been reported with COVID positive because they took the COVID in endoscopy unit in the entire region of Milano that has been at the epicenter of pandemic for many months, it's very, very minimal. What does it mean? It means that if we take the right measures, so if we do right triage, if we protect ourselves, if we use PPE, if we ask the patients to use their PPE, if we are careful with the social distancing, also among people working in endoscopy, if we respect all these rules, the risk for a patient to get contaminated from COVID in the endoscopy department is almost nil. And also I want to add, we are collecting data on all hospital workers being infected in the endoscopy department in the region of Milano. And most of the new infections, we had a couple of nurses being infected. They got the infection at home from kids. They didn't get the infection in the hospital. So
I would like to are you able to convince your patients that your endoscopy room is a safe place?
That's a great point. I'm not sure I'm doing a great job in this sense because we're having about 10 to 15% of patients canceling and postponing their appointments. So we are a little bit concerned. The feeling is that those patients with the symptoms or those patients being scheduled for treatment for conditions that are very symptomatic, they are scared because they have a big polyps or they have achalasia or they have cholangitis or they have pancreatic cancer, they are all coming. Differently from the first wave, we do not have any problem with this kind of patients. Mostly we have patients into the screening program for colorectal cancer, or patients coming for follow-up after polyp resection or with mild symptoms. So in the future, I think we need to provide evidence to our patients rather than ourselves. So rather than publishing big papers in Nature in big journals, we should inform our patients that endoscopy is a very safe place. And we have data on that. And if we do not convince them, we risk to miss diagnosis, and we risk the patients, they get out of our control and they come back in 1 year, in 2 years, when it can be too late.
Yes. So, Emmanuel, I ask you, what do you do in your unit to prevent transmission?
So we, of course, we select but I fully agree with Ali. I think people are much more contaminated outside of endoscopy unit than inside endoscopy unit, which is very safe. We didn't have cases in our endoscopy staff while colleagues were contaminated in other departments. So what we do is that we try to select the patients, and we test, of course, patients that are symptomatic or that could be suspicious for COVID. We select the indications.
So not everybody. You don't.
Not
do
everybody.
It.
Not no. everybody.
But you ask questions before they come to the unit whether they are sick.
Exactly. During a few days before and the day before, just the day before, the afternoon before endoscopy, they have a nurse questioning them by phone. And then we protect ourselves with surgical gowns, glasses, the mask, etc. And I think it's quite safe. What is more difficult is to circulate the air between patients. Honestly, I'm not sure we are doing a fantastic job about this, but I don't know how many people can really follow the rules. And what is interesting is that we had two periods in France. The first period from March 15 to June 15, where every endoscopy was canceled except for emergencies. So I think it was a national decision to postpone everything that was not cholangitis or hemorrhage. And now during the second phase, because we are confined for the moment, there was a position paper from the Society of Oncology and Society of Endoscopy to alert the administrations that we need to keep screening programs, diagnostic endoscopy, etc. Otherwise, we will never get the correct, I think, diagnosis in time for our patients, and the delay will not be manageable. If you have for 2 months, it's okay, but if you have it for 6 months, it's impossible to get back to a normal situation. So we keep normal activity for the moment.
Yeah. Okay, and are you able to convince your patients to come indeed?
Same as Ali, we have people who cancel, and we are not, I think we try to reassure them, but it's a media stuff, which should go to media and make more proactive communication. But we have probably 10 to 20% patients canceling or not coming to appointments.
So Pradeep, are you in now? Yes. So you were quite enthusiastic about the new face shield. Would that help to convince patients to come or colleagues to come to work?
Well, I think in England, we are, for a long time now, we are testing everybody before their endoscopy. So every patient who comes for endoscopy gets tested 3 days before the procedure. So that's one big reassurance. You can debate about sensitivity and prevalence and negative predictive value. We don't have time to go into that. But I think it's a very safe situation if patients have all tested negative. So we start with that, and that reassures people. Then the second, this business of using this novel mouth guard, I think is very attractive option. We need to see a little bit more data, but my own opinion, Evelyn, is that aerosol, we have lived with aerosol for many years in endoscopy. Aerosol is not a problem. It's the infected aerosol which is a problem. So if you can make sure the patient is not infected, then you don't need to worry about aerosol. If you are not sure of the patient's infection status, then obviously all these precautions are very important, and having a mouth guard can be a huge asset.
Yeah. Yeah, but there will come a time that also, even in the UK, from what I understand, you're extremely cautious by testing every patient. There will come a time that you won't do that anymore, right? And you can't probably either tell the patients they all have to get their vaccine, because some just won't. So so maybe then it would be a good protection method?
I agree. I think any uncertainty, best is to use an FP3 mask and this new protective mouth guard for the patient. It's very easy to use. Patient tolerance is very good. So I think it's very important to think about these simple protective measures. And I was just going to comment very quickly on the turnaround time in unit, which has been a big problem for a lot of centers, because they were demanding 20 and 30 minute break time between procedure for aerosols to settle down. And again, we try to manage that again with this testing business to say this aerosol is not infected, so we don't need this business of downtime for half an hour. But now the prevalence has gone up so much that people are beginning to worry, and there's a lot of anxiety in the staff. So it's the difficult, it's not all about science, it's about managing expectation and anxieties as well.
Yeah, so again, probably information for both patients as well as doctors and colleagues is crucial. Let's go to Germany, to Ralf. How about your situation? Do you also test every patient, and what precautions do you take?
Yeah, we just have changed our test strategy. We started that only inpatients receive the PCR testing. But because now the incidence is so high in Germany, we speak about 100 to 300 per 100,000. Now all the patients which are coming for outpatient treatment in the endoscopy unit will receive an antigen testing. And only if they are negative, they are allowed to enter the endoscopic unit. We also now more focused on the staff, and we do also testing for the staff every 14 days to also make sure that we have not infected staff members treating our patients. So yes, Germany has changed his way how testing was done. We started to test everybody who came back from vacation. Now we do the testing more in the hospitals.
Yeah. So and Ralf, how do you protect yourself when a patient has COVID? And how do you protect yourself if you don't know the COVID status at all? Is that the same or is it different?
So we change between, or we differentiate between upper and lower endoscopy. In the upper endoscopy, we always would recommend FFP2 or 3 mask and also glasses and your full protection. Whereas in colonoscopy, you can go with a normal mask. And we also try for colonoscopy that people will stay with their own mask in the room even when they are sedated. And that's possible because we do a lot of propofol sedation and people are very calm during the procedure. So that is how we deal at the moment during the COVID-19 pandemic.
Yeah. So Professor Neumann, is it the same in your unit as you are in Germany as well?
Yeah, thanks, Evelyn. So indeed, I think we have learned a lot during the last 6 months, during the last since the last first big outbreak. And I feel the initial recommendations from Alessandro, they are still valid. So they have been very good. And what we have learned is, and I feel this is most important, and even this has been mentioned by Professor Ripici before, we have to support our patients. I feel endoscopy, our endoscopy rooms, they're really the maybe the most safest place at the moment, because we're all wearing the personal protective equipment. We are cautious. We know about the disease since a long time now. We're not afraid. We are professionals. We know how to handle diseases, and we all hope the best for ourselves and the families and our members. However, I feel the problem is really to address the patients, yeah, and to regain trustment for endoscopy procedures. Gladfully in our unit, so most patients do not cancel their procedures, although of course, even in the last 2 weeks, we see that there is increasing incidence again of patients canceling procedures since, again, there have been lockdown light now in Germany, what they call it. But in this specific thing, I also believe what Pradeep has mentioned before, that specifically maybe even this mouth guard might be something what might even help, you know, supporting the patients in a better feeling for the procedures.
Yeah. So, and how about triaging? Do you, we are speaking now about patients deciding whether they come or not. On the other hand, I think it's challenging times for us. We can triage patients who we want to come and who we can tell they can come later, but also keeping track of all the different lists of patients and calling them back in if they canceled is quite challenging as well, I think. How do you handle that?
Ah, that's a very important point, and I'm keen to learn how you are doing it, but we don't do it, you know. So I feel we have to live with the disease. So it started in the early 2020 for us in Europe. Now we have to live with it. We have to live with it in 2021 as well, and maybe even in 22. But we cannot postpone the procedures. We need to do the screening. We need to do the regular examinations in our patients. So as long as it's possible, we do not exclude any patients anymore at the moment from endoscopy procedures.
But
we have done it in the first wave. Yeah, we have done it in the first wave, but at the moment we don't do it.
But I guess you still have a backlog from the first wave, or have you totally worked around that already?
Gladfully indeed, because it's already a couple of months ago, so there is not that much backload left for us. Yeah, but of course you're right. So especially in June, July, August, we really had much more procedures than normal. Yeah, but gladfully, you know, because the nurses, for example, in our units, they have not worked during the outbreak. Yeah, but they have been paid for this specific time as well, because we argue you get your money, yeah, but you do not have to work because there was the first outbreak and the lockdown. But when we are able to work again, then we need to work a little bit harder every day and not going back home at 3 p.m., but maybe later. And this yields that we have been really able to, you know, to make this wave, what you have mentioned, a little bit lower.
Yeah. Well, I thank you all very much. I think it was a wonderful symposium. I've really enjoyed it. I hope the audience did as well. I would like to thank all the different speakers and demonstrators. And of course, I would like to thank both chairs, Professor Alessandro Ripici and Professor Rush, on organizing again such a wonderful symposium. And I would like to close also by thanking our big sponsor for today, Fujifilm, for making this possible. I wish you a very nice evening or day or night, wherever you are. And I hope to see you back in real life soon enough. Thank you so much and see you again.
Fujifilm is a pioneer in diagnostic imaging. With over 70 years of expertise, we put cutting-edge tools in our customers' hands so patients get excellent results. Now we introduce Eluxio Ultra. Eluxio Ultra enhances your existing Eluxio platform by incorporating CAD-i, our powerful AI technology. With CAD-i, Eluxio Ultra is one of the first endoscopy solutions to detect and characterize lesions in real time, delivering our most powerful, complete, and comprehensive package for endoscopists. Eluxio Ultra will accommodate a range of future tools and technologies as they evolve, so our best endoscopy system for your patients today will remain so tomorrow. Human instinct plus artificial intelligence equals Eluxio Ultra, now available for your practice.